if you kneel, it automatically puts you in a posture in your heart that is so different than when you're sitting or standing.
Yeah.
If you kneel, you and me, everything changes inside. You cannot kneel before God and think, wow, I am amazing right now. You know, you think, wow, okay, I am this, it's a humble place.
Yeah.
When you lift your hands, it does something inside of you.
We all have those moments where we need a little encouragement to get through our day. Someone to remind us that we are not alone. Find peace. Embrace joy. Seek God daily. Welcome to Jesus Calling Stories of Faith. Our guests today are Grammy Award-winning and Platinum Record-selling worship leader Chris Tomlin and pastor and author Darren Whitehead. Chris and Darren share insight toward unlocking the mysteries in how we praise God and how our lives are transformed when we learn to live a life of praise. We also hear the story behind Chris's praise and worship song known around the globe, How Great Is Our God. And Darren tells us how to spot God working in our lives in ways we may not expect. They weave some of these thoughts in the new book they've written together called Holy Roar, 7 Words That Will Change the Way You Worship.
I'm Chris Tomlin, a songwriter, musician. I've been traveling, touring for, I guess, a little over 20 years now. Live in Franklin, Tennessee, but I'm a Texan through and through. Was born in East Texas, and it's been an amazing journey. Would have never thought that these little songs I started writing when I was a bit younger would have gone around the world like they have. But for me, I would probably say I spent most of my life chasing my songs around the world.
My name's Darren Whitehead. I'm the senior pastor of Church of the City. We're in Nashville and in New York. We have 7 different locations, 5 in the Nashville area and then 2 in New York City. And as you can tell, I'm originally from Mississippi. I'm from Australia, and I moved to the United States in 1998. So it's been 21 years that I've been living in this beautiful country.
We're sitting in our church here at Church of the City in Franklin, Tennessee. And I was so moved. He began this message on praise. And I immediately checked out, if we can just be honest on this podcast. I immediately checked out. And
lots of people check out when I start preaching.
That's what happens at our church.
It's kind of normal.
Wow, the music was good. Here comes Darren. But he said, oh, I'm going to do this thing on worship. And I'm just kidding. I wasn't checked out. I was like, okay, this is interesting. But what I thought is, like, I've heard every message on worship you could possibly give, right? I give those around the world. I talk about this. This is what I spend my life doing. And he's beginning to share this message on praise. And immediately I thought, how have I never heard this before? And I was so, it was just grabbed me. And I thought, this is game changing. I could feel it in our congregation that morning. You could just feel the, wow, this is a revelation from the scriptures that I don't think most of us have ever heard on why we praise God, what it means to praise God. And instantly, as soon as I got out of the service, I was texting Darren, blowing his phone up, saying, that may be the most powerful and most important message on praise I have ever heard in my life. Everyone needs to hear this. You need to write a book. I just kept saying, you need to write a book on this. This is so powerful, because I thought, if I've never heard this, and this is what I think about all the time and do, then how many people are sitting around in churches all over this country and didn't know that this is what the scripture really says about praise? And so that started this journey, this very unlikely journey.
It was.
Of the two of us writing this book together called Holy Roar. I especially love the little subtitle, 7 Words That Will Change the Way You Worship.
Many people know that in the New Testament, there are 4 Greek words for the word love. There is eros and storge and agape and phileo. And they all mean something slightly different, but they're all translated into the English word love. Well, in the Psalms, there are 7 Hebrew words for the English word praise. It's all translated praise. So anytime you see praise the Lord or I will praise you or any other time the word praise shows up, it's one of seven different Hebrew words. All of this is hiding underneath the surface. So Holy Roar is our best attempt to explain what each of these seven words actually mean. And they all mean something slightly different. One means to lift your hands in the presence of the Lord. Another means to sing a new song. Another means to shout. Another means to kneel. And as you learn a little more about each one of these words, it actually changes the way you worship. And so that has been the testimony of so many people that have read the book. And we're thrilled to hear that because it's grown their understanding of what praise actually means. So one of the words is taldah. And taldah is a very, very special word to me, one of my favorites. Specifically, the definition is, taldah is an extension of the hand, thanksgiving, a confession, a sacrifice of praise. Thanksgiving for things not yet received. And what is so beautiful about this is the idea of taldah is the idea of lifting your hands in praise. It's thanking God for what he has done, but it's also thanking God for what he has not yet done. It is lifting your hands in faith. It is lifting your hands and praising him because of who he is, because his promises are true, because his character is trustworthy. And you're saying, I am choosing to put my trust in you instead of in my circumstances. So I'm going to thank you for what has happened, but I'm also going to praise you for what has not yet happened, what I'm believing for. I had a friend many years ago, a man who walked with Jesus like few people that I'd ever met. His name was Ken. And we worked together. And one day I was in his office and he said, you know, pray for me. I got a situation going on with my family. He said, my daughter was at a party last night and she has not come home and we don't know where she is. I said, mate, you must be worried out of your mind. He said this, I'll never forget this. He said, I don't worry, I worship. You see, when he was tempted to be thinking on that which was out of his control, he instead focused on the one who is in control. And he actually moved his worry to worship. Instead of being stuck in worry, he actually proactively lifted his eyes and started to worship the one who's in control. And I've never forgotten that. This is the essence of taldah. It is, I will trust you when I'm uncertain. I will trust you when I'm afraid. I will worship you when I am anxious. I will lift my hands to you for that which has happened and that which has not yet happened. I will trust you.
I think a lot of people come and they, you know, you raise your hands to God when in praise because it's just natural human expression, right? That's just a natural thing to do, to lift your hands in celebration and praise, right? But what this book does, what the Hebrew word, a couple of those words do is like, it really informs that that is what Scripture's been saying to do for thousands of years. And that is a incredible part of praise, is to lift your hands. There's these words that say pray. We just say praise the Lord, but this Hebrew word says lift your hands to the Lord. It's like, oh my goodness, and like Darren said, kneel before the Lord. And what I've found is that what happens a lot of times, what happens on the outside as far as our posture of worship really changes what goes on the inside. And the opposite is true too. What is in the heart usually comes out in our postures as well. You're feeling this like celebration or this surrender to God, and you just put your hands out. You know, just it's human nature to do that. And so what this book has done is just, it's sharing all that's all in the Psalms. That is actually all through the Scripture, all through the Psalms, of how we praise God, of what God is saying, what praise really is. And it's been amazing to hear stories and to see this happen on our tours.
Yeah.
Where the light bulb comes on for people. And how many times after a concert or you've given this message, people come up and they say, for the first time in my life, I lifted my hands because I think they heard the Scripture. They heard the power, the truth, what the Scripture's been teaching. And so in the book, Holy Roar, I talk about this song with the word Shabbat, which is one of the seven Hebrew words of praise. And just how how that song to me really captures that word, Shabbat. But one of the stories for that song, the song had been around for a while. When I wrote the song, I had no idea that it would become the song it became. I can remember sitting in my little apartment condo in Austin, Texas, on my sofa with my guitar, Psalm 104, I can still see it, on the coffee table, looking at Psalm 104, and it says, "You, O Lord, are very great. You're clothed with splendor and majesty. You wrap yourself in light as a garment." It has these beautiful expressions of just the power, the majesty, the greatness of God. And for some, I just started strumming my guitar and just started singing that chorus, "How great is our God." It was very simple. I didn't really think this song is going to go around the world and people are going to sing it. There was none of that.
Just your voices and the piano. We sing, come on, how great, how
fast forward a few years, and now the song is taken off, and people are singing it, and it's being translated in all these languages and all these things. And I was recording this album. Yeah, I think the album was called Hello Love. If you go and look on some of my discography stuff, you can see this record, Hello Love. You'll see a song on there called Love, and it says with Toto Children's Choir. And when I was recording this song, I thought, man, I could just hear this choir, this I could hear a children's choir singing this with me. I just had this feeling, and I only knew one children's choir, and it was the Watoto Children's Choir out of Uganda. These are all most of these kids are AIDS orphans, but it's this beautiful ministry in Uganda that takes these kids and gives them a chance in life, and it's beautiful what they do. And they have these, and they put these choirs together, these kids, and they travel all over the world and they sing. And they they light up a room when they sing. They've sung for kings, for presidents all over the world. They're amazing, beautiful kids. And that's the only people I knew, so I thought, I'll just reach out. I could reach out to them, see if I could, if they have some recording equipment in Uganda, I could send it to them and say, could you just sing something on this? I would love. I get in touch with one of the leaders and says, actually, we're in Nashville next week. And I was like, what? And I said, I'm in the studio such and such these days. And they said, we have one day off. We're on a 6-month tour of the United States, and we have one day off in Nashville. And we're in Nashville on that day off, and it's next week when you're recording. And I was like, okay, Lord, this is obvious. And I remember them coming in that day, and I said, I'd love for you to come sing with me in the studio. And they were in Ocean Way Studio in Nashville. And I remember them walking in, and these beautiful kids. There was about 20 or 30 of them, and they were all kind of just, they're kids. They're 6 years old, 7 years old, 8 years old. They have not been in a studio like this before, so it's microphones everywhere. It's the big recording studio. You got band, you got musicians everywhere. They were kind of like, what in the world? You could just tell there was a little nervousness, and I was sitting in the booth, in the control room, and they were out where they were going to be singing, And I just remember their leader saying, "Hey, guys, let's just get comfortable. Let's just start singing. Let's just start worshiping God." And all these kids just start singing, "How great is our God." They have no idea who I am. They're 6-year-old kids in Uganda. They're AIDS orphans. And I'm sitting there, and it wasn't like, "Hey, it's Chris here. Let's sing, How Great is Our God." That was just a song they sang. And tears just started coming to my face. I was thinking, how do you write a song in your little apartment in Austin, and it makes its way to an orphanage in Uganda, and this is when it just says, "Hey, let's just sing a song to God." This is the song they start singing. Was one of the most humbling moments in my life. I was thinking, wow, Lord, it's amazing. And I was one of those moments where you're just like, gosh, God, you just to be a part of that, just be a part of His kingdom in that way. It's just so beautiful. It's amazing to me how music is the universal language of the world, right? We all speak different languages, but everybody speaks music. It's amazing. Wherever I go, it brings people together like no other thing can do, and it's so powerful.
There are more people coming to Christ in the continent of Africa than any other time in human history. I mean, there is a movement of God that is taking place there that is just extraordinary. And I love to see the next generation. One generation declares to the next generation the Shabak, the praises of God, and then the next generation take hold of that as their own and rise up with their own voice. It just excites me to see that. You know, when we make praising God a lifestyle, He guides us in ways that we are aware of and ways that we are not aware of. I think about when I moved to the United States, I was working in radio. And I came to the United States to work in radio. That's what I thought I was doing. And I went to Melbourne, Australia, to the American Embassy. And I lined up with a bunch of other hopeful immigrants to try to come to the United States to work at this radio station. And as I applied for this particular visa, they worked on it and so forth. And then they ended up handing me a visa. And as I opened it up, I looked and I realized that they'd given me the wrong kind of visa. They actually gave me a visa that I wasn't even eligible for. They gave me a pastor's visa. And I'm thinking, they've made an administrative error, but there's really nothing I can do about this. They've given me a pastor's visa. I've never been a pastor before. I have no plans of ever becoming a pastor. And yet, to go to America, now I've got to be a pastor. And so sometimes people ask me, how did the Lord call you into the ministry? I say, the U.S. government called me into this thing. And out of fear of deportation, I just keep preaching every single week. This is what I do. And I know that it's a really serendipitous story of being called into the ministry of the word at a church. But that's my story. That is actually how God has guided me. And little did I know that He was guiding me in ways that I knew of, in ways that I completely was unaware of, but that He had wired me and He had called me to work at a church in ministry as a pastor. Mm-hmm. And He guided me through the process of the American government and the embassy and the INS in allowing me to come to the US with a religious worker, a pastor's visa. Interestingly, we planted our church 6 years ago, and we were quite nervous when we were planting our church. Church planting is kind of a risk. You know, I have a wife and three daughters, and I'm not sure whether this is going to work. And so we were quite nervous. And my wife has been doing the daily devotions for Jesus Calling for many years, and. What she would do, and you know, there's on the Jesus Calling book that she has, like this one, there's space around the area, and she was just kind of writing the details of what was happening on each of the days as she was reading it each day. Now, that was great, and you know, she got through the first year, but what was fascinating is the next year she was looking day by day on the things that had happened on each of the same days. And she would see that the things that we were praying for, or the things that we were asking God for on one particular day was one thing. But then we're looking at a year later and seeing how dramatically things had changed the next year. And the specificity that she would feel from the words that came day by day in Jesus Calling was really quite remarkable. Now, the reason that's particularly significant is that 6 years ago we planted our church, and we've really had a pretty remarkable story. Our church is about 7,000 people coming now. And so you can imagine that year to year to year to year, there's been dramatic changes. And we've gone from dozens of people to hundreds of people to thousands of people. And when we look at the things that we were praying for on any particular day and then look at the following year, it's incredible to see the difference a year makes. And then how specific the words on each of these different days are speaking directly into the situation we're in. And then a year later, in a completely different way, speaking directly into the situation again. And so Jesus Calling has been actually a treasured part of our story, and it has tracked with us year by year through my wife's devotionals.
This is January 7th in Jesus Calling. This is the devotional for that day. It is impossible to praise or thank me too much. As it is written, I inhabit the praises of my people. Sometimes your adoration is a spontaneous overflow of joy in response to radiant beauty or rich blessings. At other times, your praise is more disciplined and measured, an act of your will. I dwell equally in both types of praise. Thankfulness also is a royal road to draw near me. A thankful heart has plenty of room for me. When you thank me for the many pleasures I provide, you affirm that I am God, from whom all blessings flow. When adversity strikes and you thank me anyway, your trust in my sovereignty is a showpiece in invisible realms. Fill up the spare moments of your life with praise and thanksgiving. This joyous discipline will help you live in the intimacy of my presence. Worship is, it's universal. It is a universal language. And just to play a small role in that has been an incredible journey in my life. The Good, Good Father, right? What an incredible song. What a special song that has been around the world. And Pat Barrett, it was the writer of that song. It was co-written with Pat Barrett and Tony Brown. And we were recording this song for my record, and I wanted Pat to be a part of it. I'm like, this song came from you, and I'm so honored to sing this and carry it, and hopefully it goes so wide and wow, did that ever happen? I mean, that thing has just gone everywhere. Well, in the recording, that I remember that one of the days of recording, we spent a few days working on it. And Pat was playing acoustic on it, singing all the harmonies with me and all those kind of things. And I just had this download. It was like a download from heaven of an idea for a children's book. Because this song, it has a childlike kind of thing about it, right? Even the title and the way the chorus is sung, kids pick up on this song mm-hmm. so easily. They just love to sing it. And I thought, wow, if you could translate this into a story or something for kids, it just makes so much sense. And the idea just came to me. And one day, and I went to Pat, and I said, Pat, I've got this. We were in the studio, and I said, Pat, I've got this idea for our song, Good Good Father, the song we're working on. What would you think about it being a children's book at this children's store? And he's like, are you kidding me? I was like, no. And I gave him this idea. I said, you know, what if it was? I'll never forget. I had two daughters, right? So what if it was this little girl, and she's traveling through all these villages, and she's meeting all these different people who tell her one thing about God, and the next thing in the next village tell her something else about God. And I was thinking, because the first line of the song, oh, I've heard 1,000 stories of what they say you're like. Just that one line, the whole idea of the book came to me. I was like, wow, if you could show all these different attributes of God, and that the maybe the child gets confused, and oh, the one town says he's a warrior, the next town says no, he's more like a farmer, and one town says no, he's more like a doctor, and she's confused. She's like, I don't know who this great king is, this God, this king, who is this king? I want to know this king. And obviously, when she gets to meet the king, she's like, I'm confused. I don't know who you are. But he says, you're this, you're that, you're that, and the king can say, I'm all these things. I'm a good father. A father does all these things. That's what a father is. He provides. He protects. He is a warrior. He is a doctor. He wants to look after you. He is a farmer. He does provide for you. He's all these things. So I had this little kid's story going on. And then I sent this to Pat. That's all I said. The next day in my email is the whole thing written out from Pat. I'm just like, who is this guy? He had every conversation written. He said, man, I couldn't sleep. This was it. And we had just the best time making this book what it became, because then we took it to our publishers and they say, this is really nice, but it'd be really great if it was animals. And we were like, animals? So I went back to Pat and I was like, Pat, they said it's gotta be animals. And he's like, okay. And so the next day it's all redone, and it's now this little bear going to see turtles and raccoons. and squirrels and all these different things. And I was like, oh, this is fun. And then we bring it back to our publishers and like, nice, we got it to second base. Now it needs to have, the bear needs to have a name, because all we had was bear. That was our name for our character.
Creative.
Bear.
Yeah.
And they're like, the bear needs to have a name. And I'll never forget this conversation. It's one of my favorite things that's ever happened is we're sitting around this round table and all the publishing teams in there and they're like, the bear needs to have a name. They're like, like Corduroy. That's like a great name. Like for, that was such a good, kids love that. And I was like, yeah, my kids love the Corduroy books. They love these books of Corduroy. Like, the bear needs to have a name. So I go back to Pat and I was like, guess what? Our bear needs to have a name. And they said, they suggest like I was telling Pat on the phone, like Corduroy. And he just starts laughing. And I'm like, what are you laughing about? He said, oh, well, that was my great uncle wrote those books. I was like, what? He goes, all these children's books has come from your family? He said, yes. It's like one of our prized things of our family is that's my mom's uncle wrote the Corduroy books. And I'm just like, no wonder you can just download a children's story like
it's
that.
It's genetic.
Yeah. And so obviously ours became Tucker, the name of the bear, and this good father story finally came to be. It's been so fun to read that to my own kids, and just teach them about God as being all these things. Yeah, there are a million things that God, all these different things of what a good father really is, and for kids to understand God as a father.
We'll be right back with a wrap-up of our interview with Chris Tomlin and Darren Whitehead after this brief message about a beautiful new edition of Jesus Calling. Share His love. Share His inspiration. Share His strength. Share His joy. Jesus Calling. Welcome back to our interview with Chris Tomlin and Darren Whitehead as they expound further on the themes of their book, Holy Roar, and how inhabiting a life of praise changes us from the inside and has an influence on those around us as well.
One thing I love about consistently the themes in the Psalms is that it says that one generation shall declare to the next generation the goodness of God. That word declare is actually the word shabak. And it's translated praise in many cases, in this case, and in some translations it says praise, but in the NIV it says declare. One generation shall shabak to the next generation. And I love the beauty and the unity of just one generation singing of the faithfulness of God to the next generation. We're also seeing around the country and certainly in our church, young people that are rising up and just embracing with their hearts the power of what it means to be praising and worshiping God. Recently, in our church, a couple of kids who were in high school in our local area, they had such a heart for worship that they started reaching out to other kids in other high schools. Now this was just a bunch of kids. There were no adults that were involved in this. This was a collection of 15 and 16 year olds. But they just said, what if instead of our high schools being known for rivaling one another at football games, what if we were united together for a night of worship? A bunch of kids did this. So they reached out to some other friends from another high school and then another high school and another high school, and they started promoting this on social media. They came to me and said, could we like do something? Could we use the building to like have a worship time? And I thought, this is so sweet. These kids want to do it. Like, what room do you want? You want one of our back rooms? And they're like, no, we want the main auditorium, And I'm like, bro, you know, that's going to look kind of rough. If, you know, a big auditorium with a handful of kids, and they're like, well, we think we're going to have some more. And I'm like, that's so sweet that they think that. But if you want it, then okay, you know. So these kids start promoting on social media that our county, the county schools, are going to unite together. And the county's Williamson County, as they called it, Wilco Unites. And so it rolled around, and they had 1,100 kids all show up to worship together. Yeah. And I'm telling you, like, so there's no grown-ups involved. There's no adults. And we're just standing at the back end. We're looking at this going, this may be the most holy thing I've ever seen.
Mm.
There's a bunch of teenagers saying, we are about uniting together to worship Jesus together.
One of the things that I've tried to convince Darren of, and have done a really good job of convincing him of, is like, would you, wherever I go, I was like, Darren, wherever I go for the next, I thought for the next 6 months, it's turned into almost 2 years.
That's right.
Wherever I go, whatever city I go, would you come and share this message? I think it will change the night, every night. And we're about to go on our next, we're out on the road now. This whole spring is covering more cities that we haven't been to. With this message. And as I thought, just as I thought, it has come true. Every night, the concert before Darren, I call it BDAD. The concert before Darren is one thing, and then after he shares this message, and we come back up, and we lead again, and it goes back into the music, it's a completely different night. Every single night. And that is the beauty of this message. And I think that's why this message is so important for the church, because people grab it. And I've had so many people come to me and meet and greets afterwards. I can't tell you. And one, I'll never forget this one guy. One guy, he was like, I am so frustrated. And I was like, oh, nice to meet you. kind of thing. And I was like, he's like, you know, he was, I remember he was this Catholic brother. He goes, I'm thinking my priest knows this message. And he knows about these words, and he hasn't told us about these words. And I was like, you know, and he was like, this is game changing. I want my whole church to know this is what praise is. And then next person, hey, my church, I've never heard this. We've never heard this message. We want our people to hear this message. And the next, I'll meet somebody else. I had no idea this is what's in the scripture about praising God. I'll never praise God the same. Every night of this tour, it's been so powerful to see, you know, what's happened with this message. So yeah, we're taking this all around the country. That's why it's called the Holy Roar Tour.
What we hope that people will get from this book is an expanded understanding of what it really means to praise God.
And my hope is that I think this book could really change the way so many churches across this nation respond in praise, because it's God's word. It's not just two guys writing a thing just to try to pump people up. This is God's word of saying this is what praise is.
Mm.
To learn more about Chris and Darren's new book, Holy Roar, and to find out where you can see their Holy Roar tour, please visit holyroar.com. Next time on Jesus Calling Stories of Faith, we talk with comedian Shonda Pierce. Shonda's new documentary, Unashamed, hits theaters in May 2019.
I think the world forgets that this thing we call relationship with Jesus, it is more than just a Sunday morning, you know, gathering or the Easter egg hunt for the, you know, kids at church. It's more than that. It's something that's so grafted into your heart, into your very being, that it changes your life.
Thank you for watching Jesus Calling Stories of Faith. To learn more about how to keep up with our shows bi-monthly and to listen to our weekly podcast, please visit youtube.com/JesusCallingBook to view and hear previous episodes, and to watch a short informational video about how to access all things Jesus Calling on audio and video formats. Plus, learn how to subscribe to our podcast and video channels. Your subscription helps get the word out to more people who will benefit from these inspirational stories of faith.